today we will install a distributed mode Hadoop cluster. So right now what we are using as part of IntelliPack is a single node cluster which has all the daemons running on that. So that is called as standalone because everything is on a single server. So it's a single node cluster. So we will be going ahead and installing a multi-node cluster. So the setup will be something like this. We will have four machines, four AWS instances, because we don't have physical machines. We don't have the servers in our lab with us. So we will be using virtual machines. These machines are provided by Amazon. So I'll show how to sign up for an Amazon account and how to get these instances running. They have 370 hours free cluster running, these instances running free for you. So you can use per month 370 hours for free. So you all guys can try after this session to create four instances and set up the multi-node cluster. This is a distributed cluster. And in this class actually we will be understanding how to create these AWS machines and how to install Hadoop on these four machines. So the setup will be, on the first machine we will be installing the name node and resource manager and history server, three services, three daemons or three components essentially. And on the second machine we will be installing secondary name node, which is used for name node HA. On the third machine we will be installing the data node and node manager services. On the fourth machine we will be installing data node and node manager. So these two will be third and fourth machines will be your data nodes. First machine will be your name node. So it will be a three node cluster, and there will be a secondary name node which is required for a name node HA. Let us go ahead. First we will see how to get AWS machines. So you can sign up for an account to your browser and say aws.amazon.com. Okay. And here you have sign in to the console. So for the first time when you sign in, it will ask several details and your credit card or debit card. And once you have given those details, it will create an account for you. So you can directly log into that account. Once you log in, you can see on the top, you can see orange box. And then you can see console. So you can see the services. Click on the services, and we need EC2 instances, which are virtual machines. So we are going to click on EC2. So once you click on this, it will show a dashboard. You can click on the launch instance here. This is the launch instance. Instance means one server kind of thing. So you can say launch instance. It will ask which operating system you want to launch. So I'm going to take Ubuntu server 14.04. So this is the machine I'm going to select. So you can select this machine. Yes, say select. And by default it uses t2.micro, and that is free for you. So you can take that and use a next, configure instance details. And here instead of one, because you need four machines, you just can change these number of instances, means number of machines you want is four, and no need to change anything else inside this. So just say next, add storage. In the add storage, you add size of 8 GB. So here you can put 8, okay. And then say next, add tags. So the name will be, you can put any name. So you can put Hadoop cluster for admin class. And next say service. So this is just a tag, means actually with which it identifies your machines as a group. Now you can say configure security group. Here you have to add two more new rules so that actually you can access these machines from outside the network. So first rule is all TCP, and second rule is all ICMP 4, okay, and then you can say review and launch. Okay, you can just say this is your security group. So we can add these security groups later also. Just I'll remove that. Review and launch, and finally you can say launch. Here it will ask you to create a key pair. By default you will not be having any key pairs, so you can say create new key pair, and you can call this as Hadoop cluster for admin class. Okay, and then just say download this key pair, because this is the key pair required for accessing these machines from your laptop. Okay, so this is very important. Just download this key pair. So it will be downloaded a .pem file. I'm just saving that from downloads to some other location. So .pem file will be created. This is Hadoop cluster for admin class .pem. That's the same name .pem. And after that you can just say launch instances. So it will be creating 4 instances. Now it is saying your instances are launching. So click on these instances, any of these instances. It will take you to that particular machine. Okay, so it says pending. After some time it will start running. So that means actually the machine will be ready for us to, so there are 8 machines because I have already created 4 before this class. So these, whatever I have marked, these 4 are the 4 new machines which got created now. And 4 of them started running. Okay, so all of them are in running state. So now you can go ahead and use these machines for creating a multi-node cluster. First we will rename these machines. You can click on this pen symbol. It will allow you to rename. So the first machine I call it as name node, cluster name node. Okay, so the second I call it as cluster secondary name node. Third machine I'll call it as cluster data node. There is a spelling mistake. Okay. And this is cluster data node 1, and this is cluster data node 2. Okay. I have created 4 machines. Let me just remove the previous machines. So these 4 machines which are running are our machines which we will be using for today's class to create the cluster. So first one is name node, second one is secondary name node, third one is data node, and fourth one is data node I just call data node 1, data node 2. Okay, so these are the four machines. So if you see our setup, it has name node, secondary name node, data node 1 and data node 2. So we are going to use these four machines for installing that. And how to connect a machine, I'll show. So we have to connect this machine from SSH. So if you just click on the connect, it will show what to do. So we already have this file called Hadoop cluster for admin class PEM. Hadoop underscore cluster. Okay. So this is the file I have downloaded, Hadoop cluster for admin class PEM. So I can say, so it is saying like first we have to do chmod. So I just copy this command, paste it here. So and after that I can access the name node. So click on the name node and say connect. And this is the command which you can use. You can directly copy this and connect to it. Now it's connected. So you are on that machine which is your name node, and you can say exit to come out of that machine. Now you can open a text file and save the public host name of that. So whatever is given here, that is the host name which is given by AWS. And you say this is your name node and you are able to access it. Next, close this, try to access the secondary name node. So this is how we can access the secondary name node. I'll send the instructions of the after this class how they can do with screenshots from my Windows machine. Okay, so I'm able to access secondary name node also. I'll say exit and I'll save this host name. This is my secondary name node. I'm going to install all these. Right now these are not name nodes or secondary name nodes. I'm going to use them as name node and secondary name node. Now I'll go and try to see data node. So this is how I can connect to this machine. So this is to check whether all the machines are up and running and whether I am able to access those machines. So I am able to access data node 1 and I'll save this file, this host name. This is my data node 1. Okay. And finally I'll check whether I'm able to access data node 2. So I'm able to access data node 2 also. I can save this host name. So these are the four machines we have created in AWS, and we are going to use this machine as name node, this machine as secondary name node, this machine as data node 1, and this machine as data node 2. So that is what we have done in the AWS console. This is called as AWS console, EC2 management console. In this actually we have started four nodes for EC2 instances, and we tried to log in to those instances, and we saved the host names of those instances to create to install these components on the on those machines. Okay. Now, anybody has any questions till now? So that is how we create 4 machines. Because we don't have physical machines, we are doing all these things. In your lab, if you have the machines, no need to do this. I'll take some questions now, so that actually we can start the deployment of Hadoop cluster.
Prashad Inan asking, like, do we need to pay Amazon for getting this access, or it is free for all of us?
So they will charge 2 rupees for the first time on into your credit card or debit card, whatever you have added, and you can use this free for 370 hours. For suppose if you start today morning, okay, you can start them continuously for around 15 days per month. So every month you can use continuously 15 days. So if you stop those instances and then restart, then you can save that time. So every day you can use these instances for 12 hours, for 30 days.
Great. Can we use Google App Engine or any other VM provider like DigitalOcean?
Anything actually. You can use any software or any cloud provider to get your machines. So it's like we are showing AWS, but you can use any machines. That's not a problem.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, Vir. It's good. Please go ahead.
Yeah. So, my question actually you answered. So it doesn't matter that we have to use AWS. We can use any other VM provider. Okay.
Because yes, you can use physical machines also if you have. It's like ultimately we need some machines which have OS running on that.
Okay, now there is another question. So let's. What I was planning to do was I was planning to run a VirtualBox instance, 4 VirtualBox instance on my local machine.
Make sure that you have enough RAM.
Yeah, that I have on my desktop.
Yeah.
So how much RAM do you think is required for each machine?
Make sure at least you have 4 GB RAM.
4 GB RAM for each one of them.
Yeah.
And how many processors? Single processor will work.
You can give 1 core per each machine. That's not a problem.
That's fine. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Next question, please.
You can ask.
Hello. Yeah. Yes. So my question is, you said that we have to use PuTTY for this, right?
No. We can use either any SSH client. PuTTY is also essentially SSH client, right? So your Mac and Linux boxes will be having SSH directly as a client. But if you are using a Windows machine, then you have to use PuTTY. So I'll be sending the PDF in which actually it says how to add this PEM file to your PuTTY so that it directly access the machine without giving username or password. Because when I'm accessing the machines here, I'm not giving username and password, right, for SSH?
Right.
Yeah. So I'm just telling, I'm just giving this key, which is the PEM file, right, permission file. So I'll send that instruction how to give the same thing in SSH. In PuTTY, we normally give username and password, right?
Right.
Yeah.
That's correct. So right now on my system, I have Windows installed and I have VirtualBox installed given by this IntelliBab team, right?
Yeah, that's a single node machine.
Sorry?
That's a single node. Yeah.
Yes, correct. So let's say if I'm using PuTTY, right? Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. I'll be using my Windows system, am I correct?
Yeah, correct.
Okay, so for Windows system?
Windows means actually your host is Windows. But your guest actually, the machines on which you install Hadoop are not Windows machine.
Yes, that's correct. What my question is, when I'm using PuTTY, okay, so I'll be using through host system or the guest system?
You will be using through host system only, right?
That is from my Windows system, correct?
From your Windows. From your Windows, you open a PuTTY. For right. example, now I am on Mac. I am using SSH client, right? From there, actually, I am accessing AWS machines.
All right. So you'll be sending all these instructions, right?
Yeah, yeah. So that's two screenshots I'll be sending. So in which actually you can just browse and give this PAM file. And when you give the host name, this whole host name and the username as Ubuntu, it will be immediately logging in without asking password. Normally, PuTTY will ask password after that, right?
Okay, fine, got it. And yeah. My next question is, you said that we need to, when I sign up for this AWS EC instance, I'd be paying some 2 rupees or something, right?
So first you have to give your credit card or debit card details to it. Otherwise, it won't sign up.
Yeah, that's correct. So two rupees will be debited from my account, and later on I'd be getting an access for 370 hours or minutes, you said?
Hours.
Okay. So after that, what are the charges?
After that, actually, you have to see the charge list given in Amazon. It depends on the instance you have taken, number of instances, the total number of runtime, like how many hours it is up and all. So there is a calculator in that. You can calculate that.
Okay, fine. And my last question is that I think during the course of your explanation, you used the command chmod 400, right?
Yeah, correct.
So what is that ch? Because see, I'm not from the Unix background, and I hope that you know many of us are not from the Unix background. So
no problem. Actually, so that is not related to our course. That is a instruction given by AWS. If you see, I have just copy pasted from the AWS, right? So it's nothing to do with our course. AWS, if you go on to an instance, click on that instance and say connect, it is giving me the instruction, right? chmod and all.
Right.
Okay. So this you will not be doing in Windows. Okay. That is right. Done in a Unix machines like a Mac or any other Linux machines. Okay. Right. So to make sure that this PEM file is not visible to others. Okay. That's what chmod says. It's not visible to everybody. So you see on top you say your key must not be publicly viewable for SSH. Okay.
Yeah, but in as per our previous discussion, I'd be using Windows system and then I'd be using PuTTY, right?
You will not be doing this.
But I think when you were explaining this, I think you did use this command, right? But you were using PuTTY.
Yeah, I'm not using PuTTY. I'm using SSH. So whatever the instruction here I have given, I'm using the same thing.
Okay.
So if you go into the same link, okay, here you can see open a SSH client, which is what I am using because I am having SSH client. But if you are using PuTTY, just click on this.
Okay. Yeah,
it will give this help. But I will be sending the same document by trying on my machine, taking the screenshots to you, so that if something is not working directly, so I can help you because this document sometimes might be older or something, right? So I'll be sending those screenshots. Yeah, but it has the instructions. The instructions are there.
Okay, fine.
But sometimes it will be very long for you to follow. So I'll be sending.
If I want to use this SSH client through my guest system, that is my virtual box, so would that be available? Like you know,
correct.
If I
fine. I got your question. First question properly now. So you are saying that you want to try doing all these things from your guest machine because it's a Linux machine. Yeah, yes. It's perfectly fine. It's like any other machine. You can do that.
Okay, so what I do is I open my Unix command, right? That command prompt, and then I these commands, right? This open.
Yeah, so that is Unix command prompt is called as terminal. So you can open a terminal, and then you can start working on that.
Okay, fine.
Yeah. Next question, please.
Yes, this is Kailash here. I have a question. Kailash. I just wanted to confirm what I understand. So far you were presented. So right now, what you did is actually when you say machine, you mean virtual machine on the Amazon servers, right?
Yeah.
So the Amazon might have some other operating system, not essentially Ubuntu, or it might be the server where you have created these virtual machines might be a Windows server, correct?
These machines are running Ubuntu only because I have selected Ubuntu.
Right, but when you say machines, you mean the virtual machine on the Amazon EC2 platform, right?
Yeah, but those machines, the virtual machines, I have selected to run as Ubuntu, so the operating system inside this is Ubuntu.
Correct. When you, that is what, when you keep saying machine, you mean this is not a physical, it might not be a physical server, right?
Correct.
It might
Correct.
Be a virtual machine that is running on top of a server which has some other operating system, like which we don't know, right? Which we don't care about, right?
Yeah, which we don't care about, but we have explicitly selected for this example Ubuntu. Yeah, but it can run any OS based on.
Okay, let me rephrase that. What I'm asking is the Amazon servers that you have selected, underlying operating system might be different, but on top of it, they might have installed a virtual machine just like we did for standalone, right?
Completely correct. You are completely correct.
Okay. And you told about something like tc dot some file name, right? Key file.
Yeah.
In your representation.
Temp file.
No, not temp file. The before that you said that you had to store some key file. Can you go back to the present slide?
Yeah, that key file is nothing but your temp file. I'll show you the keys. Once you create it also, you can access that. Okay.
Okay.
So here you see key pairs.
Correct.
Right, you click on that.
Okay.
This is the second one, is the key I have just created. Okay.
Okay. And when you say terminal from, when you choose terminal from your screen, you are actually using the terminal on the Amazon EC2, not on the standalone, right? That we have installed on our, because our local Windows server that I'm using laptop, I have installed CentOS Linux, but you are not accessing that now. You are accessing the Amazon EC2 Ubuntu server.
Your Windows is having CMD, right? CMD, command prompt?
Correct.
So similarly...
No, what I'm asking is, part of IntelliPack training, they asked us to install CentOS. So that is for single machine installation.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a separate machine. I'm not using that machine now. Okay. So
right.
Whatever
the one that's going terminal is on the Amazon
on my Mac laptop. That's on my Mac laptop.
Oh, okay. So if I want to use that for that, then I have to log into the CentOS server and then access that, right?
Access it, or otherwise from your Windows machine also, you can install a software called PuTTY, P-U-T-T-Y.
Uh-huh.
And
okay.
After that, if you can actually browse this PEM file using that PuTTY, you can you will also get the similar kind of screen, like a terminal. Like, but it will
correct. But how do I go to the Amazon instance? Now, whatever you are doing is on Amazon instance or is on your local laptop that you are having?
If you see this command, right? ssh-i pem file. Uh-huh. Ubuntu is the username, @
okay.
And this is the host name. Okay. Every machine will have a host name, right?
This host name is on the Amazon server.
Yeah, that is the host name. Correct. I'll show where that host name will be. Okay.
Okay.
You can just go to the instances.
Okay.
And I am on this I want to first access cluster name node. Okay.
Okay.
Just scroll horizontally. You can see public DNS.
Oh, okay.
So this is like last one is 144.96.
Okay.
So if I want to access this, I'll just copy this. Okay, I'm just copying this.
Uh-huh.
Command ssh-i. Okay, and I'm
using
the temp file. So that that is the public private key kind of thing, which will not ask for password. Okay. And by default, these instances will be creating Ubuntu as user. Okay.
Okay.
@ and then paste the host name. Okay.
Host name. Right, and the reason you are using 400 for PEM file is someone doesn't use and create instances using this. That's why you have a read-only for your owner and the zero for others, right?
Correct. So now I'm able to access into this machine. Once I do SSH, now if you see, initially it was something else, my prompt, but now my prompt is something else, right? Because I logged into this machine. Now I'm under the different...
So the next step you will be doing is installing the Hadoop daemons on whatever nodes that you have mentioned, right? On the what you call the name node that you have mentioned as name node for admin training, and that you will install the name node daemons and the resource manager daemons, correct? That step you have.
We didn't actually. Even we didn't download it the Hadoop software, right?
Okay, so the Hadoop software will be installed on those four VM instances that you created on Amazon EC2, correct?
Exactly.
Okay. Now I understood. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you, Yash. Thank you.
Next question.
Yes, this is Raja. So I think my question got answered partially. My question was about the Cloudera distribution, because we have just provisioned the four machines, and now probably the next step would be to install the Hadoop software, right?
Correct. So we are not installing the Cloudera here. We are installing the Apache, because Cloudera installation is very easy. So we don't understand the internals of the deployment. Okay, so we are going to install everything by hand, so we know what is happening inside. Okay.
Okay. But Cloudera is also possible, right?
Cloudera is also possible. So it's very easy, because Cloudera, Cloudera allows you to install everything from browser. Okay. So you can just select this machine is my secondary name node, this machine is my primary name node, this is data node, this is NetDataTo. It will create all the XML files and all on itself. Then we don't probably get much out of the exercise.
Yep, I understand. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
But not many companies follow the Apache distribution directly, right? They either go for Cloudera or...
Correct. So if something goes wrong, we should be able to understand from where, because Cloudera also will be using the same files. And it will also be filling the same files, but instead of manually filling them, it will be filling through a web server. Okay, it will go to the back end, and there is a Cloudera agent which will be doing that. But exactly same way it will also do as we are doing with hand. Okay.
Okay.
If something goes wrong, actually you can understand now what is the problem. So you have better insight into that.
Okay, then one more last question about the operating system. So Hadoop can go only on top of Linux, or it could go over Windows as well?
Windows is not at least fully supported. Somebody might be trying it, but it's not officially supported at all. But it is not mandatory that all of your machines should have the same Linux versions. Okay. So if you have all the same Linux versions, that is called as homogeneous cluster, where all the nodes are of the same type. If you have different OSs, then it is called as heterogeneous cluster. So you can have one Ubuntu machine, one CentOS machine, one RHEL machine, like that.
Okay, that's good to know. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, that's all. Thanks, Yash.
Thanks.
Hey, Yash, this is Ajit.
Yeah. Hi.
Yash, can you go back to the Amazon Web Services?
Sorry?
Can you go to the Amazon Web AWS?
Yeah.
Okay. So can you scroll left to the most? Yeah. Here actually there are eight instances, right?
Yeah. So because before this class, actually I started the four instances to try these steps. Okay.
So only four, we will get only four things.
Yeah, you can start any number of instances. Because if you see this slide, I'll show. In this slide, actually, you are selecting number of instances here. Okay. So here I selected as four, so you'll get four. You can even select 50 also. It's up to you.
Okay. Okay, and another question is first you installed it and then you terminate the process. Okay.
Machines I deleted. So red is actually terminated, means machines are no more. I cannot access them. I cannot recover them back.
Okay, so this way we can permanently delete those. Okay.
Correct.
And another question is, is there any other panel as well? Ubuntu is an option. Is there any other OS as well in Amazon?
You can use CentOS. So I'll just go to launch. Okay, so these are all the OSs you have. Amazon Linux is a separate thing. SUSE, RHEL, Ubuntu. Microsoft Server is there, but we cannot use it for our purpose. Now, what we can use is, we can use SUSE, we can use RHEL, we can use Ubuntu. Let me see if we have CentOS somewhere. We don't have CentOS, okay? So these are the three things you can use, definitely. Okay? So one is RHEL, one is SUSE, and one is Ubuntu.
And yeah, and the last question is, like, can you please show again, like, how did you start the Ubuntu panel? From where we need to open that?
Which one?
Like the Ubuntu panel, like the terminal where you started typing the commands.
Okay, so are you from, do you have Windows machine?
Yeah, I have Windows machine.
Okay, so either you can use the IntelliPad VM because it has Linux in this, inside which you have terminal. Okay, you can use SSH, all these commands from there. Okay, but if you want to use Windows itself directly, you have to use a software called PuTTY. Okay, you have to download PuTTY and you can access these machines. Okay, PuTTY is also SSH agent. So SSH is a service which allows you to connect to remote machines and work on that. Okay, SSH is a protocol actually. So
okay.
So we are using the same. It has a server and agent. So server is already running on this machine and we are connecting from our agent which is installed on the, so by default Linux will be having, Linux or Mac will be having, because mine is a Mac box, I have a SSH client. But Windows doesn't have SSH client, so we install PuTTY.
Okay, and at the background, like, we need to connect PuTTY to the AWS services, so
correct.
For that you will be sending some PDF, right?
Yeah, so it is already there here, but I'll be sending, so it is there here actually. So when, once you go to any of the instance, okay, click on the instance and say connect. So it says open SSH client. At the same time, it says find out how to connect to PuTTY.
Okay, okay. Yeah.
And this also shows the same information. Okay, this is the PuTTY actually. So here you will be giving the host name and then the port. So, and here you will be giving the key pair and it will be able to connect to the machine. Okay.
Okay, okay, fine. Yeah. Good. Thank you.
Yeah. No problem. Next question, please.
Hello, yes.
Can you hear? Yeah, hi. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm doing good.
Yeah. You're talking about how to connect the virtual machine. Can we make use of the central operating system we have on our Windows or laptop to connect to the AWS?
Yeah, you can. You can use that. Yeah, you can use that.
But on the AMI on AWS, we don't have CentOS. There's only, I mean, Ubuntu, the Amazon Linux, and
No, from it is not required that you should have CentOS on AWS, right? So you can use terminal of CentOS which you already have to connect to those AWS machines. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, Ash. This is Srikant.
Hi.
My question is, like, okay, so we are developing the cluster, Hadoop cluster, using Amazon Web Services, right? So is it something like, okay, our VM is also part of the cluster, or it is entirely a different background, like how the HDFS is built on the Hadoop cluster in the real-time companies? We are just making use of AWS to build up our own Hadoop cluster. That is what we are doing, right?
Correct. So in real time, actually, we will be having multiple machines which might be on our premises in the lab of our company. But right now, we don't have that luxury. So we are taking some AWS instances and trying to do that.
Okay, so then our machine, how it will be coordinating with that is, is it through Hue or what is our machine's role here, our laptop or whatever?
Our laptop is like, we are just logging from our laptop, logging into those machines, that's it. Actually, our laptop is not taking part in this cluster at all. Cluster means only those four machines actually, whatever we have created.
Okay, so these four machines are only for HDFS?
Yeah, HDFS and YARN. we have to install both, right?
Yeah,
later you can also install the ecosystem components like Hive, Pig and all.
Oh, those components also will be installed on those four machines or?
Yeah, in this session we are only installing these services, but tomorrow we will be installing Scoop and all those things. Okay. Scoop, Flume and all. Yeah. But you can also install, like, because already we have covered Hive and Pig, you can also install Hive and Pig on these machines.
Okay. So where exactly our own terminal exists? Is in those four machines or in on our own laptop?
On our own laptop we have the terminal.
Okay.
So terminal is only just like a browser. We are connecting to that machine and looking at what is happening.
Yes, that's what I wanted to know actually.
Yeah,
correct. So still we are using our own laptop, but we are making use of those four nodes, four machines for building the HDFS or Hadoop cluster and making use of
correct.
That one.
Correct.
Okay. Sure. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you. Next question, please.
Hi. When you said that it gives chmod 400.
Yeah.
That chmod is just for the read and write for owner of the file.
Correct. And I have done that because AWS has asked me. I mean, it's as simple as that, right?
Yeah, but in Putty, when you are trying to do from Windows, that's not needed because...
Yeah, that's not needed. So you have to just follow the instructions which are given in the next link, okay?
Okay.
They might have given the complete instructions, right? Yeah. Okay. Because Windows doesn't have that kind of chmod command at all.
Thanks.
Yeah. Thank you. Next question, please.
Yeah, Yash. This is Kailash again. Actually, just a quick question. In the real time, when we have our own company data centers, this is just for our learning purpose, right? You are trying to, because we don't have a data center to set up four machines and clusters, right?
Yeah.
So this is for using the Amazon web service or EC2 service to mimic the four nodes, correct?
Yeah. So not only that, sometimes what will happen is even if you have your own if you have your own data centers, sometimes we need a small setup, small cluster for our development environment, okay, just to try something. And it may not, you may not have enough time to go through the DevOps to get these machines. So you can directly take the AWS machines and try it.
Okay. And the other question is similar to what we did for our local laptop where we have installed the CentOS. So you are going to show us the process of installing those Hadoop daemons on the EC2 going forward, right? In the next discussion.
Correct. Only difference is in case of laptop, we have installed all these daemons like name node, resource manager, history manager, data node manager, everything. Those five daemons we have installed on the same machine. But now have distributed those daemons to different machines and we are going to install them.
So what are admin, that in that you will install name node resource manager kind of thing, correct?
Correct.
You will be spreading out those daemons into the four machines.
I will be starting them separately. Okay. So.
Okay.
Yeah.
No, my question is, you will be installing the four daemons in separate machines now, instead of having a single node cluster now, correct?
Yeah, correct.
And one last question is, you have configured the memory as or hard disk as 8 GB, but from earlier discussion we mentioned that name node needs more memory than the data nodes and secondary name node because it maintains the block metadata, right? So is it configurable also in each of those machines separate memory? Because you didn't show us like you share everything will be 8 GB for the instances. So,
yeah, you can create different instances. I mean, instead of four instances with the same copy, you can create one instance at a time and have different configurations.
Okay, and Amazon charges per based on the disk size or based on how many long hours you are running.
It has a different calculation actually. So it will charge on both the hours and disk. And memory and everything.
And for 370 hours or whatever you mentioned, it is free, right? Every month. Okay. So this is just for our learning purpose, but in actual production scenario, the data centers will be set up. Our company data centers will take care of that, correct?
Exactly.
Yeah, thanks, Yash. Yeah, it's clear now. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. So should we move ahead with the cluster installation? So I can take some questions later. So, but first we will move ahead with cluster installation. So see, I have noted down the machines, whatever the machines we are going to use with their host names. So this host is nothing but my name node. This host is nothing but my secondary name node. But there is a problem with Amazon Web Service. So if you go into any of these machines, okay, I'm going into name node. So what I can do is SSH minus I, and then user, your PEM file, and then user is Ubuntu at the rate, this one. When I go into this machine, and when I say host name is a command which shows me the host name. So the host name is different than what I'm expecting. Okay, so we have to correct that. To correct that, you just copy the host name, whatever you want, the same host name with which actually you are using it, and just say host name and space this host name. And we can only change host name as root. So I'm just adding sudo. So sudo host name, and you give the new host name. So what will happen is, if you again say host name to check what is the host name is changed. Okay, so what we are doing is we are making sure that whatever the host name with which we are accessing, that machine has the same host name. Normally they maintain two different host names outside, one is outside and one is inside. But because it makes us confusion more when we are actually trying to install, so we are going to change the host name. And now I'll also change the host name for secondary name node. Minus I Ubuntu at the rate. Okay. Now I am going into secondary name node 93207. Now you say host name. So it's something else. So I am going to change the host name, sudo host name, this one. Now you say host name. So host name is changed properly and come out of that. So I'll repeat the same steps for data nodes also. I have just changed the host name for data node 1. I'll do the same thing for data node 2. This is my data node 2. Host name. So when you give host name, it changed. So I have changed host name for all the machines from name node to data node 2. Now, because all the daemons will be started from name node, so all the daemons will be started, stopped, and restarted through name node. We should have a way to access all other machines from name node without any password. Okay, so that is called as passwordless SSH, which means actually from name node, if I am on the name node, I will be able to log into any of the other machines, all these three machines, without giving password for the SSH, without giving the password for these machines, I will be able to access. So that allows name node to start the daemons on these machines. Okay, so it will be easy for installation. So we will, for doing that, we will follow the steps. So this is what we will do. We will scp pem file to the name node. Okay, I'll tell you how to do that. So this is the name node. I'll use a command called scp. Scp means actually copying this file. Ubuntu@this, and to the location home Ubuntu. Okay, so here minus I, this pem file says that I am going to use this key value pair to log in to this machine, and this pem file says that I am transferring, copying this file into Ubuntu, into the Ubuntu user of the name node, and later you are giving the directory to which actually it has to copy. Once you say that, it will copy this file. Okay, now you can log into this machine and see whether it copied the file or not. SSH minus I. You have logged into that machine. Now you say ls here. You can see this file. So this is the file which got copied into this machine. Now, because of this file, it will be able to access the other in the setup. Now name node will be able to access the other data nodes and secondary name node because it has this pem file. Okay. Now let us move ahead. So for doing cluster installation, first we have to log into the every node and install Java. Java is required because Hadoop uses Java. So we have to install JDK 7 into these machines. So to install that, apt-get is like an installer for your Ubuntu. Yum is for CentOS. And apt-get is a software which actually installs the new softwares onto the Ubuntu. Okay, so apt-get will do that. So we have to just use these commands for installing Java on every machine. We have to repeat the same thing. Sudo, because apt-get we can't install or uninstall any softwares on Ubuntu from different users. We can only install through root user. So we say sudo and apt-get update. It is actually updating its repositories, its details, what softwares it has. Okay. Then you add the location where it can find Java. And now we are actually installing JDK. Say OK in the screen and say S here. Now it will install Java. So once Java is installed, we can validate whether Java is installed properly or not by giving a command Java minus -version. Okay, so it should give this kind of information. So this means actually Java is installed. Now I will come out of this machine. So I have successfully installed Java on name node. I have to repeat the same steps on secondary name node and data nodes. So my secondary name node is this one. So I'm logging into my secondary name node. Remember, Java is required because Hadoop uses Java. Now the same steps, not doing anything different. This we are doing on secondary name node. We should repeat the same steps on data node 1 and data node 2. In this screen, select yes. Once it's done, you verify whether Java is installed properly or not using this command. Yeah, it's installed. So I'll come out of that. Now I have completed installation of Java on secondary name node. I'll do the same thing on data node 1. So I'm logging into data node 1. I'll follow the same steps. Once installation is done, so we are installing Java on data node 1. We'll verify whether Java is installed properly or not. Java minus version. Yeah, it's installed. Now you exit, come out of that. Now you have to follow the same steps on data node 2, which is this. I'm logging into that data node 2. I'll follow the same steps to install Java. If Java is not installed on any of the node, then your Hadoop installation will fail on that node. So make sure that your Java is there. So this is on data node 2, we are installing Java. So we have to install Java on name node, secondary name node, data node, and data node 1 and data node 2, all the data nodes. You try Java minus version to see whether it is installed. It is installed. So now we have successfully installed Java on all the nodes. Now let us move ahead. Now we have to download Hadoop on all the nodes. So let us download this Hadoop. To download Hadoop, we use wget. So wget is a tool to download files. So now I'll first connect to name node. Name node is this host name, Ubuntu at the rate. Yeah, you have logged into this. Now you say wget. This link has the Hadoop 2.5.2. So I'm using that. You can say wget. So it will download this file. If you say ls, ls will list the files. You can see there is a tar.gz file. So this is the file which we have downloaded from net. So to download any file from internet, in Linux, we use wget. Now, because tar.gz is like a zip file, it's a compressed file, we have to uncompress it. To uncompress it, you use tar minus xzf. Okay. Now you uncompress it. I think like this is, and go to this page. Yeah, you have to copy this location, because that link, whatever is there, it is actually redirecting to another site. So it is not downloading the actual zip. So you go to the site and copy this link address and duplicate that. So this will download the actual file. Have downloaded it. Okay. Now you see the file size. So it's around 141 MB. So this is the correct file. Now you use *-xzf because *.zz is like a compressed file. It's like a zip file. We have to uncompress it to use it. So *-xzf, X stands for extract, which means like open, and F stands for force. Okay, Z stands for ZZ because it's starting with, it's ending with ZZ. So now if you say ls, list the files, here you see a directory. So Hadoop-2.5.2. So that's the directory which got created after extracting this zip file. So you can rename that Hadoop-2.5.2 to just Hadoop so that we can easily use it. Okay, I just renamed it. Move will rename. It has moved this folder to this folder, which is nothing but rename. So now I can see it is Hadoop instead of Hadoop-2.5.2. You can use cd to go into the directory. So cd Hadoop and say ls, there are some files here. So this is what actually Hadoop installation is. We have downloaded the Hadoop software onto this node. We have to repeat the same thing on all the five nodes. Okay, on all the other three nodes. Okay, now I'll come out of this and I'll go to secondary name node is this host Ubuntu@. Okay, so I'm logging into secondary name node. I'll download that file, duplicate. So now you say ls, which means list of the files and directories. Now you have this file, and now you use the same command *-xzf, which will actually uncompress this zip file. Now you say ls, it has created this directory. So now you rename this directory to just Hadoop. Now you see there is a directory called Hadoop. Okay, so that means you have downloaded the software on secondary name node also. Now let us download the same file on data node 1. We have to repeat on data node 2 also the same thing. We're going to @. This is logged in. You see ls, there is no file. We are just downloading that file. Yeah, we can do that also. We can copy the same folder from those machines. I just renamed it. I'm doing the same thing on my data node 2. So we have to have this Hadoop folder on all the machines. Okay. So whatever the machines you want to include onto the cluster, all these machines should have. So you are using four machines. So we are copying the same information onto four machines. So I have this folder on this machine. So we are done with downloading the Hadoop on all the machines. Now let us go to the next slide. So now we have to set up some environmental variables on all these machines. Okay. So first environmental variable is Hadoop_conf. And second environment variable is Hadoop_prefix. So Hadoop_prefix is the directory in which actually we have all these Hadoop files. So we have downloaded it into the home Ubuntu, and we have renamed Hadoop-2.5.2 as Hadoop. So all the files of Hadoop are in home Ubuntu Hadoop. Okay. So if I am going to log into name node. If you log into the name node and just say pwd is present working directory, you are in /home/ubuntu. So if you say cd hadoop and say pwd, you are in home ubuntu hadoop, and you say ls, so you have all the hadoop software related files inside this directory. So this directory is called as Hadoop_prefix. Okay, and inside this directory you have etc. Okay, if you just go to etc, you have one more directory called Hadoop. You go into this Hadoop. So this is the location where you have XML files which we have looked at into in the class 1 of administration. So this is the location where it can get all the XML files and conf files. So this is the location which you have to give in Hadoop_conf. Okay, so this is the conf and this is your prefix, and you have installed java is installed in user lib jvm java 7 oracle. So this is the location. So you have to add all this information into your bash rc so that actually whenever you use these environmental variables, it knows what is the meaning of this environmental variable. It knows that Hadoop prefix means home Ubuntu Hadoop, and Hadoop conf means home Ubuntu Hadoop etc Hadoop. Okay, so that is what we have to do. We'll just copy this whatever is there and put it into the /bash rc. Okay, so you just add, go to the end and then say I and you paste it here. Okay, so this will be pasted here and save this using :wq means actually write and quit, which means we are saying save the file and close it. So it closed. Now to get these working, what we have to do is we either have to close this terminal and open, or so you can say, or else you can say source, which means you say get these variables into immediate effect. Okay, so if you say source and then bash rc, so these variables will be effective. So you can start using those variables. Just a second. Okay, you can just say echo $Hadoop prefix. Okay, and You can just say ls. So when I copied from the slides, actually there is an unprintable character which came, because of which it didn't show anything here. But it's essentially when you say ls and then Hadoop prefix, it will work. You can also say ls for a dollar Hadoop. Even you can use tab. So if you use tab, it will show whatever all our environment variables are existing. So even you can say ls Hadoop conf, it will show all these files. So this is, these environment variables are like shortcut to these directories. Okay, instead of remembering all these path, we can directly use these environmental variables called Hadoop prefix and Hadoop conf. Okay, so we can do, we have to do the same thing for other machines also. I'll just do that. For name node and secondary name node, we have to do the same thing. Go to end, save it, come out of that. Data node 1. Dash RC. Go to end. Save it. Now you have to do the same thing for data node 2 also. Ubuntu at the rate. Here this host name. So log into that. Copy the same content in bash rc, go to end and you save it. Now we are done by, for setting the environmental variables. Okay, so now now you have to log into the name node machine and run these two commands, first two commands, that will allow name node to access other machines without giving passwords. So that is called as passwordless SSH. Okay, so to do passwordless SSH means actually to allow a machine to log into other machines without giving password, we have to execute these two commands. In the first command, it's eval. And after that, it's like backticks. It's not single quotes. So you have to use backticks. So let me first log into the name node. This is my name node. Then I have to execute this command. So this will start my SSH agent. And after that, I can say SSH add. So this will remember on which node I am. This file name is different. Hadoop cluster for admin. Okay. Now this has added this identity, which means actually with this identity, when it tries to log into other machines, no machine will ask this password. Okay. It will start remembering this machine, and it will think that this machine is a trusted host. So it will not ask for any passwords and all. Okay. It will directly allow to access the machine, the file system and all. Okay. Now from here, I can directly access the secondary name node. I can try it. And I say SSH. I am not giving minus I and all. Okay. So I have not given password. See, it will allow me. Okay. I can say exit. Again, I am in the machine of name node. So from here, I can also try accessing data nodes also to see whether my password SSH is working or not. SSH, the data node. Okay. So it is able to access. Then I say SSH, I logged out from that machine. Again, I'm on the name node. I'll also access data node 2. So I'm able to access. Okay. So you can access to any machine, all these three machines, without giving any passwords. So that is the purpose of running these two commands, eval SSH agent and then SSH add, which means actually it is adding this PEM file, the key value file, to allow name node to log into other machines. Okay. So from here actually the Hadoop installation starts. So whatever we have done till now is required for allowing us to do the Hadoop installation. Okay. But this is the actual Hadoop installation we will be doing from this slide. So first we have to set the four files which we have already looked at in the last class. One is Hadoop env.sh and second one is core-site.xml. Okay, the other files we'll look into the next slide. So in the Hadoop env.ssh, we only into the Hadoop env. So Hadoop env is inside your $hadoop.env.sh. You can use this shortcut. Okay. Then if you open, there is a file here, and go and change this Java home. Okay. And then copy this and just paste it here. Okay. And save it. So you have to make these changes only on name node. No need to make these changes on different nodes because we will be copying these files into different nodes. Okay. Then the second thing what we have to do is we have to change core-site.xml. In core-site.xml, because this is not a single node machine, we cannot, in the previous slides, in the last classes, we have seen that here we have localhost colon. Because this is a distributed machine, this is distributed cluster, we are going to use the actual host name. The name node host name is EC2, 52, 38 and all. So we have to use this actual host name here. So this is the actual host name we have, because that is the name node which we have selected, 144.96. You see, this is the 144.96. Now the second property is, already we know that we have to have a directory called temp directory, and inside that temp directory it creates data node and name node directories. So we copy this and paste it into core-site.xml. Okay, inside the core-site.xml you can see there is nothing inside configuration node. Okay, so this is the XML document. So whatever starts with less than and ends with less than slash. Okay, so this is called as, this complete thing is called as node. In between these two nodes there is nothing. So we are going to paste this content. So this should be inside the configuration node. Okay, now you save this. So remember, so it is actually the host name of your name node. Now we will go to the next step. So we have to change the HDFS core.xml. We have to put replication factor, because we have only two name nodes. We have only two data nodes. We are putting replication factor as 2, because even if you put replication factor as 3, it cannot maintain the replication factor. Because you are not using MapReduce framework now, you are going to use YARN framework. We are going to set up YARN core.site.xml. Okay. So in this XML, actually we are going to put the resource manager. Remember, in the first here you can see name node is a resource manager. That means actually on the name node machine we are running the resource manager daemon also. So here resource manager is nothing but your name node's host name. So your name node host name is this. So you have to copy this and you have to use the same host name here the same host name as a resource manager, okay, and copy this whole content and paste it into, I think, like, that is not yarn core, it's actually yarn side.xml. Okay, once you change yarn site XML, HDFS site XML, core site XML, and ENV, Hadoop ENV, you have to now copy these files from the name node to other nodes. Okay, so these files we have created on the name node, but the same files will be used by all the machines. So we are going to copy the same files to other machines. Okay. What you can do is, from the name node, you can say SCP this to secondary name node first. So this is your secondary name node. Now here you have to put it into the same location on that machine. Also, you have to copy it into the same location. It has copied now. Now you will also copy the XMLs. Core site.xml. And then you will copy HDFS site.xml. Now you copy yarn site.xml. Now the same thing you have to do with data node 1 also. You have to copy the same files onto data node 1. So let me first copy Hadoop ENV to data node 1. Now we will copy core site XML. Now you copy HDFS site XML and yarn site XML. And finally to data node 2, the same files. First I'll copy the Hadoop ENV file. And then core site XML. Then HDFS site XML. And then yarn site XML. Okay. Now we have completed copying all the files. Okay, so we'll also create two more files called masters and slaves, and then we can start the daemons. Okay, so before that, let us take break, because some guys are asking for break. So I'll just recap what we have done after the previous session. So in the previous session we have created the EC2 instances, four EC2 instances. Now we have downloaded the Hadoop software on all the four machines. We have extracted and renamed the folder to Hadoop. After that, we have set up environmental variables inside bash rc, like Hadoop underscore prefix and Hadoop underscore conf. And after that, we have created four files: Hadoop env.sh. We have edited four files: Hadoop env.sh, core site XML, HDFS site XML, and yarn site XML. And these files we have edited only on name node, and we have copied these to other nodes. Okay, so once we are back, we will see how to create masters and slave files, and we will start the daemons, and we will verify our installation. Okay.
Thank you.